After this presentation about containers and specifically PowerShell's role in containers, my name is Øyvind Kalstad, and together with me is Jan-Egil Gilding.
Yes, in this session we're going to look at a few different concepts for using PowerShell together with containers. We're going to look at management of containers by using PowerShell. We're going to look at how we can use PowerShell inside of containers, and we're going to show how we can use Windows and Linux containers side by side. So from this point on, I think we have only demos. So this was basically the last slide, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to start with a demo showing a little bit about how we can use Docker, which is the management, most popular management tool for containers. So we're going to have a look at how we can use the Docker CLI from PowerShell. And one great thing about the Docker CLI is that it supports outputting things in JSON. And as we all know, PowerShell has great support for JSON. So as a proof of concept here, if you just type start a demo container, that will run basically just hello world from the command line. When that has started, we can run the Docker PS command to show the list of all of the containers that has run and the status of it. So since I added the dash dash all parameter, it listed also this container that started and stopped right away. It just was a hello world example that printed some text. And here we have the dash dash format JSON example, which will take all of the text that we saw here. This is just pure text, converted to JSON. And here we go and have a full PowerShell object back. So if we pipe that to get member, we will see that it's a PowerShell custom object. So that's great. And also Docker has many different commands, PS for listing containers, images for listing container images. That's the base image that you start a container from. So for example, if you do the same thing with Docker images, we can convert it into PowerShell objects and work with it as we're used to in PowerShell. We created a proof of concept module called PS Docker Tools that contains three wrapper functions around what I just showed you. So if you look at the content of the first one, here we have basically just the Docker PS dash dash all, the command that I just showed you, wrapped in a function. The same with a few other ones. So if you just import this module, have a look at the functions. We can, for example, get Docker container and get the same results back. So this is just a proof of concept module. But when we started to work on this, Eivind asked me, have you looked at the PowerShell gallery and seen if there are any existing Docker modules there? Because it's no point in reinventing the wheel if something already exists. So before we put any more work into this module, we can just go ahead and have a quick tour of what is available for managing Docker containers with PowerShell. So Microsoft has this module called PowerShell for Docker. It's a PowerShell module for the Docker engine, and it's not a wrapper for Docker CLI, which was what I just showed you, but this is an alternative to using the Docker command line interface, because it talks directly to the Docker daemon or the Docker service. So to install it, you have to register the repository where it is available. And if you do a get command against it, you can see that we have different commands available for working with the Docker containers. For example, get container, which will show the exact same thing that we saw earlier. We also have commands for starting a new container. So instead of using Docker run, for instance, you can use new container, specify the command you want to run, and that you want a terminal, an interactive experience, and not just a container starting in the background as a service. So let's just go ahead and run that, and that should pop up a terminal window with PowerShell in it. And this is based on the Windows Server Core image, the 1709 one. And when you use the Docker command line to start it, it will automatically start the container, but here you see that you have to pipe it to start container as well in order to make it start. So if you now do a get container, or this thing to see if so here is, for example, one example of, you can't see the red text, but it's an error message stating that the response not found. So the module is still in alpha, so and it hasn't been updated for the last 2 years. So it's obviously not in active development, but it looked very promising, but due to the issue, different issues you can see here, some commands are just hanging. One command responded with a not found. So probably Docker has been developed with new API features that the module does not support yet. So I don't know what is happening to that module, but it looks dead. So at this point, I moved on to the PowerShell gallery, did a find module, and had a look at what's available on there with the Docker in the name. This will take some time, so I'm just, they run pretty quickly actually. So here you can see there are many different modules. So I went through this list and had a look at a few of them. I'm not going to go through everyone, but I'm going to show a few of them that looked interesting. So if you start with the PS Docker Hub, Docker Hub is a repository for working with Docker images, much like PowerShell Gallery is for PowerShell modules and artifacts. Docker Hub is for interacting with that gallery. I have pre-installed it, so we don't have to wait for it. So you just can have a quick look at the available commands here. Here we can see get Docker image detail, for example, get Docker image Docker file. So it will show you the actual Docker file, which specifies how the image is built. So all of these things you can do from PowerShell instead of visiting the website hub.docker.com. So it's pretty handy to use this module for finding, discovering images. For instance, if you look at the Microsoft / the official PowerShell Docker image, we can have a look at the Docker image file for that one from PowerShell, get image details for it. So this is pretty handy and might be a very useful one. So it's no point in reinventing the wheel with regards to this module. Next step, we have a module called Docker PowerShell, which also seemed pretty promising based on the name. But this is not an official module, it's a community member that has created it. If any of you who have created some of the modules I'm going to show is in the room, please raise your hand so we can talk more about it or catch us after the session. So this one, we have, for example, many commands that map to Docker commands. For instance, invoke Docker PS, invoke Docker compose, which is Docker-specific command. So it kind of looked promising, but I'm not sure I totally agree on how the design of the command is. For instance, the use of invoke Docker and then the name of the Docker command. If you, for example, look at invoke Docker PS as an example, you can see that it under the hood, it calls invoke Docker command with the PS command and the argument. So yeah, I can understand what is being trying to accomplish here, but I didn't kind of like the overall design of it. So yeah, it's an alternative, but I moved on and looked at Docker helpers. That's another module. Here we have, for example, lot of things for showing details for volumes, for instance. But the show commands here, it's basically just wrappers around the out grid view. So it's kind of also a helper module. It's not a complete module for working with Docker, in my opinion. Then we have Docker DSE, which Ben is in a different room having a session about DSE right now, so we can talk as much we want negatively about this module. Yeah. it's a great module. It's a perfect module for configuring the Docker DSE, the Docker as a service on Windows. So we can use DSE to configure the Windows service. So that's the only thing related to Docker and DSE I found there. So we're getting back to our initial module, the proof of concept module. We're very interested in hearing opinions on, is it worth using time developing a proper community module for working with Docker, or is using Docker CLI as is the better way? Or we're open for a discussion around that. So if you have any opinions, please feel free to speak out or catch us in the hallway afterwards. Next step is a demo about Docker build.
Yep. So one thing is consuming Docker images that you download from the hub or other repositories. But if you don't know, it's quite easy to define your own images and build your own images using Docker. They use their own DSL language for writing those images. It's pretty extensively documented on the Docker site. The link is in the comments there, so when you download the code, you can see for yourself. So I'm just going to go through quickly how a simple Docker image can be built locally. So I think I have to bring up the Docker file. So this is the Docker file that I created for this demo. And how many here have actually written their own Docker file and built? Okay, so this is probably something you already know, so just bear with me. So basically, it's you tell it, or you can tell it to start with an already existing image. In this case, I'm basing it on an Ubuntu image. And what you do is you just tell Docker how to set up the environment, install packages you need, set environment variables, and stuff like that. So what I'm actually doing here in this Docker file is creating a small management image. So I'm installing PowerShell Core for Linux and the Azure CLI Python library. And then at the end of it, I'm just setting an entry point, which is PowerShell Core. So when you want to build a Docker image, it's several ways you can do that. The easiest one is to just do Docker build and dot. And it will then look in the current folder that you're at and look for the Docker file, written Docker file in one word. Or you have the dash dash F or dash F, which is just the same parameter, really, where you can define with the full path the specific Docker file you want to build. You can also pipe it by using get content. You can pipe it to the Docker build command. Just note that instead of a dot, you need to use a hyphen to tell Docker to take input from the pipeline. So besides just building an image, it's worthwhile knowing and using the tagging system that is built in Docker. If you create an image and you don't tag it, it's just listed as untagged or something like that, and it just looks ugly. If you get into a habit of actually tagging your images with a proper name and a proper version hierarchy or something, it's much easier to see when you have a new image of a new version of the image or something like that. So the way you do that is just using the dash T parameter, and you give it a tag name. So this part, does that show up? Yeah, this part, that's the tag name that I'm giving this image. So I'm not going to run the Docker build command now, because it can take quite a lot of time, because it just needs to fetch the base image if it's not already there. And then, of course, it needs to run all the commands to install. In this case, it's installing a bunch of stuff from the internet and doing an update and stuff like that. So I've pre-built that image. So that means that we can do something like this. So it's custom and version 1.0. There you go. And we are inside the container in PowerShell Core for Linux. And we also have the Azure CLI available if you want to work with our Azure infrastructure. So that was just a really, really quick overview of how easy it is to work with Docker Build. It's worth noting that in the Docker Hub, not every images there have it, but often there is a tab called Dockerfile, where you can actually look and see the Dockerfile for that image. So you can lift code directly from there or just read through it to see how it's done. Yep. So.
Yep. Next topic is, now we have talked about management of containers from the outside. Now we're going to see how we can use PowerShell inside of containers. So if you start with the first part, which is interactive use of PowerShell inside containers, there have some different options. You can use PowerShell 5.1, which is available in the PowerShell Server Core base image, which you can download. A few examples here, how you can use Dockerpool to download that image. You can also use other images that uses Server Core as their base image, for example, Internet Information Services, which has our own base image as well. There you will also have PowerShell 5.1. And PowerShell Core, of course, is available in many different images. For instance, on NanoServer, on CentOS, different Linux distributions. So there are a few of those. If you go to Docker Hub or use the Docker Hub module I showed you in the previous demo, you can get more information about the different options available there. So if you start with an example here, if you use Docker Run and start the latest PowerShell RTM image, which is the 602 in NanoServer 1709. And here we have to use the new PVSH, call that command to start the PowerShell Core version. So if you use start process to start that in a new window, we'll see that it will spin up and hopefully give us a PowerShell Core prompt eventually. So here we can see that we are inside of the of our container. So if you do hostname, you will see the ID of the container. If you just minimize this one, and we run Docker PS with the Q switch, we will see the different containers which are running here. Here I'm supposed to have the one for the one I started right now. So if we do this one, container ID, so now we have the ID for the container I just started, and now I'm going to show you how you can attach to that container. So if you use the Docker attach command and enter either the container ID or the container alias that you can see here, we have some friendly names that you can use instead of the ID. So if you run Docker attach, so now I'm attached to that container, and if I go back to the VM again and retype the hostname command, you can see when I type something in the container, it is also available on the command line. So this is kind of, you can think of it as taking control of a virtual machine, basically. So if we exit this one, the next one is to, if we start a new one, because now I closed this one, so we can't run anything against it. So if you just go ahead and have a look at what's running, or we start a new one. This was your Linux image, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So we can, does it have PowerShell in it?
Yeah.
We can just use that one. So if you use Docker exec, it will run on, no, it didn't work, but if I had started a new container, we would see that the PowerShell would have started in the same container. But the difference here is that it would start in a new process. It would not connect to the existing one. So if you run hostname in that one, we would see that it was the same container ID, but if you run $PID, we would see that the process ID was different. So you're connecting to the container, but in a different process than the console, so to speak. So if you go ahead and start another container to look at one more option, if you start that as a daemon, we are not going to start it in interactive mode. So this will just go ahead and run in the background. An instance of the Microsoft official IIS image running server core. So now we have the full PowerShell 5.1 version running in it. So if you go ahead and look at the ID, we have it there. Here we can use the exact same commands, docker attach, docker exec, when it's running as a daemon. But you also have a couple of other options I was thinking to mention here. For instance, when you're using docker exec, you can add dash dash privileged if there are anything inside of the container that you need to run as administrator on Windows container, or I suppose it will be as root on Linux containers. For example, if you're running PowerShell DSC commands on Windows containers, you need to remember to elevate. If not, you will get access denied messages. So that's handy to know that you can elevate sessions. Also, let's have a look at some commands that support the container ID parameter, because we have some native PowerShell remoting commands that you can use to connect to a container. So for instance, enter PS session, a new PS session, instead of connecting to a remote machine, you can actually connect directly to a container. So let's have a quick look at that in action. If we go ahead and start a new container in a elevated mode, let's just go ahead and start this one, for instance. Yeah, what I discovered about this is that it only works against PowerShell 5.1. It doesn't work against PowerShell Core, so I'm interested in having a discussion about that afterwards, if anyone have some ideas there. But I'm just going to quickly show you how it works here. If you run this one, and PowerShell, and yeah, just go ahead and start that from a elevated session. So we have an elevated session here. You can see that it's administrator. So let's just go ahead and run that. So you can also notice that the server core image is a bit slower to start. It takes a few more seconds. If I was starting the nano server image, it was returning about 2-3 seconds maybe, but the server core image takes maybe 10 seconds, I don't know. It's much slower. This is normal. I think it's restarting the service, so after it started. So now this container is running here. If you go ahead and connect to this one from a different elevated one, we open one more and we have a quick look at the ID. Docker PS, so now it's the newest one we are interested in, which is this one, 40 seconds ago. And now, this is a gotcha. If you try to connect to the container ID using, for instance, enter PS session, container ID, and run as administrator, this will give you an error message because enter PS session expects to get the full container ID and not just the short version. So in order to get that, we can use, for instance, docker inspect, give it the short version, and we will get the full information about the object. This, as you can see, is JSON output, so this is also something that we can wrap a wrapper function around to get a full PowerShell object back instead. So if you use the full ID of the container, enter PS session should work. So if you try again, it should now connect to the container through PS remoting. And as I explained, this is running the full PowerShell 5.1 version, but if I try to do this against a nano server image, for example, that is running PowerShell Core, it returns an error message. So I'm not sure if the enter PS session implementation for container ID the parameter is hard-coded to PowerShell.exe. I don't know, but I'm interested in suggestions or why that is. But that's a gotcha. Next, we have, you can also, of course, use invoke command or any of the commands you can see here that supports the container ID parameter. And this is the gotcha that I just mentioned. So this is interactive use. Next, we are going to look at how we can run PowerShell code inside of a container. So as I even showed you, there is this concept in Docker of a Docker file, which describes declaratively how a Docker image should be built. So inside of a Docker file, you have the opportunity to use the run command to execute things from our shell. So when you specify the run command, you have the opportunity to set which shell to use. So if you, for instance, specify shell PowerShell, all of the following run commands will use PowerShell. If I here put the CMD or PVSH or whatever, that will be used as a shell for the following commands. If you go into this folder, we're going to have a look at a demo file, a Docker file, that will build a nano server image. So here we have a few different things to show you. For instance, here is how you use PowerShell to download and install the latest version of PowerShell. So here we're specifying that we want 6.02 version of PowerShell Core. It's being downloaded from the official GitHub repository. It's being expanded by using expand archive and expanded into the PowerShell directory. Next, we are using some aspects from the ASP.NET Core image. So this is a nano server image with ASP.NET Core in it because we need that for running something called the PowerShell Universal Dashboard that Adam Driscoll has created, which easily lets you create dynamically HTML5 websites running from PowerShell. So that's the reason that we use this image. So this is a Docker file that picks parts from different Docker images and creates one image file. Next, we run some PowerShell core commands. Here we set the shell to PVSH. We create a folder on the C drive for our dashboards. We download the latest version of the universal dashboard. We copy our dashboard from the folder that we are currently in to the folder that we created, and we are here creating an entry point stating that the container should start the C dashboard file when it's started. So basically that will host a web server based on PowerShell Universal Dashboard. So you can have a quick look at that file as well, if I can find it here. Dashboard, there, thank you, this one. Yeah, dashboard.ps1. So here, for instance, I'm importing the module and configuring the license, specifying colors. This is just a demo dashboard that I downloaded from the poshud.com website, specifying how the website should look. And at the end, you're starting the dashboard on a specified port, and when you specify dash wait, it will just sit at the command line hosting that web server. So that's basically what's going to happen when you start an instance of that container. So here I'm not going to build it because it takes some time, but I have pre-built it, so we can test drive it by running docker run, running it as a daemon. We want to remove the image when the container is stopped, and we want to start a custom image that I just showed you, tagged psconf.eu nano demo website. So if you go ahead and start that, we should see that it's running. Next, we can have a look at finding the IP address for it. Here we have to specify the container ID. Yeah, that's from there. So for finding the IP address of the container, we can use Docker inspect that I showed you earlier and dig down to find the IP address. So here I should have the IP address in this variable. So this is a local IP address on a Hyper-V switch connected to this laptop. So this should work from a local web browser. So if I open up, this should show PowerShell Universal Dashboard. And the beautiful thing about this is it's running up on a PowerShell core, so I could as well as run this inside of a Linux container. It doesn't matter as long as ASP.NET Core and PowerShell Core is available. So this is the example dashboard. So this is really, really a beautiful thing. If you are going to build reports or graphs or anything, I really encourage you to check it out. Let's go ahead and stop that. Then it will also be removed since we have the rm command. And of course, regular scripts can be run inside of a container. So if you start a container based on the nano server image running PowerShell Core, we can install scripts from the gallery, for instance, as we are used to. Let's see if this works. Now we could use that to get the weather, for instance, from Hanover. So that the PowerShell gallery works, as you know, as is on PowerShell Core, but of course the script itself must support PowerShell Core. So this is running inside of a container showing the weather information. last thing is the side state configuration. That can also be used inside of a container as we are used to. But it's currently not supported on PowerShell Core, so you need to use the Windows Server Core image to use DSC or a Linux image where you have installed the PowerShell DSC for Linux, which is a separate implementation today. But this is a quote from a blog post from January from the PowerShell team, where they are giving some information about what is coming for DSC. So basically, the DSC engine is being rewritten in C++, so it will be available as a native LCM provider on different platforms, Linux, Windows, maybe other things. So there's some more information about that. So any container image that has PowerShell 4 or higher, you can leverage DSC as we are used to. So here I have an example of a very quick demo. Here I have a DSC configuration that's just making sure the spooler is stopped. That I can bring into a container by using a Docker file looking like this, which is using the 1709 server core image, specifying that I want PowerShell as the shell. I'm copying the configuration that I just showed you, which is configuring the spooler, into the container. And then I run define the configuration, dot sourcing it, so it will be available as a command. And then I'm calling the command, creating the mof file. And lastly, I'm using the run command to apply that configuration to the running operating system. So this is, if you know DSC, this is very pretty regular DSC. It can be used as is. But whether DSC is going to be used inside of a container, that's kind of a design decision, because many of the things you can do with DSC, you can also do with a Docker file, such as creating files and folders and things like that. So that's not a real answer to that, but that's kind of a design decision to what you're building. So you can go ahead and skip the build, or do you remember if you build it on this computer, this one?
I don't remember.
I can go ahead and
do Docker images.
Docker images. Takes a few seconds, so if you don't have to, you can skip it. Yeah, DSC container, there it is. So let me just skip the build, since it takes a few seconds. We're going to run it. So now we are starting the container, specifying that we want an interactive PowerShell shell. As I said earlier, it takes a few seconds, about 10 seconds for the server core image to spin up. But when that's started, we get the PowerShell prompt back, and we can run get DSC configuration to see that the configuration is applied. So now we're inside of the container. Run get DSC configuration. And we can, we should see that it's returning information about the print spooler being stopped. So this is kind of a discussion point, whether DSC or using Docker files or something else for configuring the operating system inside of the container is the right thing to do. That's a discussion point. For instance, you can configure the LCM inside of the container to go to Azure Automation and dynamically pull down updated configurations from there. That's one way to do it. So this is kind of very, very flexible. So let's not wait for that. We can just go ahead to the next demo where Evan is going to talk about side by side.
Yeah. So this is a new experimental feature that's showing what is coming in Docker for Windows. So if you have the edge build of Docker for Windows, you can enable experimental features. I'm just going to show you. Go into settings. And in daemon tag, you can turn on experimental features. What this does, it allows you to run Linux and Windows containers side by side in Docker for Windows. To be able to do that, you have to make sure that you are in Windows mode on the Docker daemon. And you of course, switch the mode here. So you can see switch to Linux means that I'm running Windows mode. So I don't know if you actually noticed it, but we've been running this in Windows mode for all the demos so far, even though we have also started some Linux containers, which means that it actually works. I'm going to expand on that a little bit with some quick demos. So let's see. Oh, it's still running.
Yeah, just
can I just quit it?
Yeah.
Hey, you broke it.
If it was.
Ah, there you go. Okay, so first I'm going to start up a Windows container running nano server with IIS. So we can see that that's running now. Oh, that was a bit. It's the big font size that's.
Yeah.
We have other stuff running that's hugging port 80, so I don't think we can test it. Okay. So that means that we're running a Windows container. And I'd like to get the ID, container IP, sorry. And that means that we should be able to run this, but now it might actually fail since the old one stopped. So, yeah. So this is the default IIS page that are shown from the Windows container that we just started. And while that is running in the background, we can start the custom management container image that I showed you in my previous demo, which is running Linux. It's a Linux container with PowerShell core. There you go. And some funny stuff there with PSReadline. So you can see there, we are running Ubuntu 17.10. And now, both of these are running side by side. So we both shows up here, this one, custom. This is the Linux container, and this is the Windows container. Both showing up at the same time on the same machine. So you can run all the commands that you would expect to both of them. The Docker run, inspect, and everything. So you don't have to switch back and forth between the Windows mode and the Linux mode. And what's more is that you're actually able to communicate between the containers. So by default, if you don't set up any particular network configuration in Docker for Windows, you just get the default network, and every container you start will be a part of the same network. And if you noticed, I also used the dash dash name to give my container images a name. And since they are part of the same network, they will automatically be able to communicate together using that name. So that means that I should be able to do an invoke web request to the container called IIS, running a Windows container, but from my Linux container. And I do. And we get a 200 OK back. And at the same time, I should be able to connect, get an interactive terminal to the Linux container. Oh. Now I'm inside the Windows container, and I should be able to have network connectivity to the Linux container. So this shows that even though it's an experimental feature and it's in the Edge build of the Docker for Windows daemon, it works pretty well. I haven't noticed any big snags. But I wouldn't use it in our production environment quite yet. We did some testing because you have the availability of enabling the experimental features in the stable build as well, but that does not include the side-by-side functionality. So we need edge build of Docker for Windows to be able to use this. So further on, we can use the Docker inspect. I just need to get out of the container. So by using Docker inspect, we can get information about the platform back. So we can see that the IIS that is running Windows. It's a bit wonky, the output here. Let's try it again. I don't know why that happens. So, it clearly states that this is a Windows container, and likewise, this one is running Linux container. So this means that if you're running Docker on a Windows platform, you actually get more features than you would if you ran it on the Linux platform. Because as far as I know, it's not easy to get a Windows container running in a Docker container if the Docker daemon is running on Linux. So this is really cool. So that's it for the demos. I'm just going to switch back to there you go.
Yeah, and finally we have this discussion point about the PS Docker Tools module that I mentioned earlier, if this is a good idea or not. So we're open for ideas if you have any. So please come and speak with us about that later today.
Yeah.
Yeah, also PowerShell is great for managing containers. As we saw that you can use convert from JSON to convert the text output from the Docker CLI into proper PowerShell objects. And that is the perfect glue for integrations across systems. You also can use it inside containers. There it's business as usual. You can start a PowerShell command line using PowerShell or PVSH like we're used to. And with PowerShell Core, we can also leverage PowerShell inside Linux and NanoServer containers, as we saw in the demos.
Also, as a little tip for you, if you use Visual Studio Code, just going to skip a little bit down here. There is pretty good extensions for Docker that you should test out if you use Docker. So this is just a couple of screenshots from that extension. So you see there that you have the ability of running the commands directly. and you get IntelliSense for both Dockerfile and also for Docker Compose, which is a topic that we haven't covered today, but it's also worth checking into if you are into that. So, yeah, just quickly, our contact information, you can reach us on Twitter and mail and our websites. And I think after this, we have a coffee break. And we have a pretty good time, so if you have any questions, we can take them now, or you can just approach us after we turn off the microphone. And we will be glad to help you. Yeah, we have a question right now. Sorry, I didn't get that. What, who's? Sorry.
If it's any use cases for Windows containers, was that the question?
Ah, okay, we got some answers from the man himself there, I think. Ah, okay, just to...
So, okay, is it better now?
Yeah.
Okay. My question was, do you have any insights in GUI for Windows containers? Because my use case would be remote application containerizing.
I'm not... Not sure. Does anyone else have any opinions on this? I'm also, what use cases there are for Windows containers or any planned features? Is that the question?
Can you RDP into a container?
You can't. No, you need to use command line PowerShell. So that's, yeah.
But as we showed, you can use PS remoting.
Yeah. Docker exec or Docker attach or PS remoting.
Mm.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you. So first of all, you were right. The PowerShell.exe is hard coded in the assembly. That's why it probably doesn't work for you. And my question is, how does it work the side by side? Do we still have the virtual machine behind it and the runtime just switches?
Yeah, it's you still have the virtual machine, the Mobi one in Hyper-V. So that's how it works. But yeah, you don't need the switching back and forth. Any other questions? Okay,
just right. Thank you.
Thank you.